Hi, I'm Andrea from AWS. When it comes to AWS cloud technology and our customers, there's nothing more important than security. That's why we want to show you some of the more innovative ways our customers are developing security solutions. Let's start with OutSystems and how they securely store data in a multi-tenant environment.
Hi, I'm Matt from AWS, and on today's episode of This Is My Architecture, I'm joined by Andy from OutSystems. Thanks for joining us.
Thanks for having me.
In our platform, we have several different kinds of data. We have a whole segment of binary data. We have a bunch of relational, core relational items that goes to defining the applications we give our customers.
Okay.
We have a bunch of data that's really configuration, or really it's key value pairs. And then the last part is a bunch of encrypted data for sensitive information.
So as part of your journey to microservices and decomposing this monolith, you're looking at the different types of data within your applications and then putting them in the different storage and database services that AWS offers, is that right?
Yes. One of the things that we're doing during our decomposition is that each of our customers, each of our tenants, will have their own instances of these different services.
So you don't have sort of a giant centralized database. You have applications team owning their own Aurora serverless instance, is that right?
Exactly, and that's the really the power of the serverless and these request-based kind of data services is that you can have different services each having their own instances of these to let my teams manage their own data but also run independently.
Okay, so you have relational data in Aurora serverless. You have key value and more sort of blob-like data in S3. I'm curious to know how you're using Secrets Manager. You know, you wouldn't associate it with database and storage services, but in this case.
Yeah, and so, you know, our current product is based on an enterprise architecture.
Yeah.
Where the only kind of predictable, well-maintained storage that you would have would be a relational database. Mm-hmm. So it became a catch-all for where we put things. Now, we don't store secrets inside of our the relational store, but we do store encrypted data.
Okay.
You know, some of the different RDS or the relational instances give you the ability to manage it, and then we also have our own app level. But that's where Secrets Manager comes in, where instead of us having to manage it, we can offload that and then, you know, use a service to securely store those items.
So instead of pre-encrypting and then loading it into the relational database, you could just put it into Secrets Manager directly.
Exactly, and then through the use of like IAM roles and other things, it allows us to ensure, you know, that tenancy boundary for our customers.
Okay, nice. So I like how you're applying, from the not only the data side and picking the right storage service and database service to meet your needs in addition to Secrets Manager, but you're also enabling a microservices-based architecture and multi-tenancy with bring your own key and KMS-based encryption that works well with these services. It's really a nice extension of what we traditionally associate with a monolith decomposition.
Next, let's explore how GoDaddy built a zero-trust environment architecture.
Security must be in your DNA.
Oh, absolutely. I mean, in order for us to remain trusted partners for our everyday entrepreneurs, like security has to be a part of our DNA. And that means that we have to put it into consideration for every design element that we talk through.
Gotcha. And with that, how do you implement that in your environment?
Absolutely. So maybe we can walk through an example. So as a user, if I say, hey, I want to create an application or something, right, in our public cloud environment, they'll go to this thing here called a public cloud portal. And that's really where they start their journey.
So in that portal, what does it do?
Yeah, so it gives them full visibility into what stage they're in before they can take production traffic in the cloud. So that'll go through a lot of that cloud readiness review, which is another name for the process that they walk through, is based on AWS as well architected, which is where we took our jumping off point. But it's going to go through your application security, your compliance, your privacy, and several different aspects to be able to create this environment that says, here's my project. What organization do I need to be a part of? We have three organizations that they can select from. And then based off of that, they'll get seven accounts created before they're even ready to take production. So in that up to 6 of those accounts are non-production accounts where they can be in dev, dev private, et cetera, completely isolated. And then one CI/CD account, which is the only account that I can reach in and do deployments. Within our EKS, we have node rotations that happen every 24 hours. So they have to rebuild every 24 hours based on our golden AMI that has all of the latest security patches, all of the latest security features, right? So worst case scenario is a threat actor exploits a vulnerability or zero day or something. They can only live up to 24 hours before everything is broken down and built back up from the latest and greatest. So with those node rotations and this isolation in place, that really allows us to contain and put security best practice in place. Additionally, on that account level, we do have run about 80 checks every 4 hours that says, are you sure you're not doing VPC peering? Are you sure you're not, you know, what are your vulnerability scans? What are your configurations? Are you rotating off of that golden AMI? On that ongoing basis. So that really allows us to strengthen our security posture.
Awesome. So through node rotation to always have the latest OS when you're deploying, and also providing that account boundary and isolation to reduce the blast radius really encompasses that zero trust environment.
Yes, absolutely.
Awesome. Well, thank you so much for going over your architecture. That is amazing how you're able to enforce these best practices so that you can be the trusted partners for the for your customers. So thank you for that.
Absolutely. Thank you so much.
Lastly, let's watch how the elegant solution built by Pinterest focused on fine-grained access control that reduced the number of clusters in their architecture.
We have, over time, teams at Pinterest have come to us and said, hey, I've got this data set, and I want to restrict access to this data set to make sure that I know how it's being used. But I also still want to have access to all the services like Hadoop and Flink, and I need to be able to build and train models off of this stuff. So how can you go and give me access to that?
Okay, so what did you do sort of before?
So before, what we would typically do is, like, each of these teams, for your sake of illustration, we'll just say that each of these teams has, like, a single AWS bucket, an S3 bucket here. So we'll have
an S3 bucket.
Yeah. Bucket one, and we'll create bucket two.
Okay.
Yeah. And what we would normally do is create an IAM role for each of these.
That grants access to the data in that bucket.
Exactly. So each of these IAM roles pairs with a bucket in this particular example. So if we go with this traditional model, what we end up doing is including this IAM role into a variety of different services. So we build out a Hadoop service, a Presto service, Airflow, all of the different systems that we count on inside of Pinterest. And so what you can see is in this model, I've basically built out two different copies of Hadoop. I have to configure them, I have to maintain them. The scale there is kind of difficult.
So that's because the instances in the Hadoop cluster, for example, have to assume the role.
Exactly.
And then to get access to the data. So if you need to have a different role, you need a different cluster.
Exactly. We've used sort of the traditional model of assigning the EC2 instances to the IAM role.
Yeah.
And as a result, they're paired. And every time I create a new IAM role in this model, I end up having to create a new set of services. Which also means that if, for example, some customer comes along tomorrow and needs to pull data from both bucket one and bucket two,
yeah,
I actually now need to create a third IAM role and a third set of my services just to maintain that. So here I've only got two different groups of data, but I've already got three different sets of services just to maintain access to them.
Okay, so fast forward to today, I guess what's over here, you have STS and you're calling assume role, right?
Yeah, we're calling assume role, and so we're passing in this base IAM role.
Yeah.
And right now in this base IAM role, we're giving permission to access both of these two buckets.
Okay.
And then we're going to create two other managed policies. We'll just call the managed policy one. And we'll have managed policy two,
yeah,
down here. So when we call assume role, if we were to pass in the base IAM role and just managed policy one, even though the base IAM role has access to both of these buckets, the actual STS token produced will only have access, in this case, to managed policy one and thus the first bucket. But if I pass in both of these managed policies, that resulting STS token will have access to both of those buckets. So I can build out all the permutations with just two managed policies here. So the token vending service is going to get a call in from customers or from EC2 instances that are running services down here and makes a call up to our LDAP service. And it gets back from that LDAP service a list of LDAP groups that that user is in.
So at Pinterest, you use LDAP internally for all of your users.
Exactly.
And groups that they're in. Okay, got
it. Yeah, so each user might have one or more LDAP groups that are related to this. So we can map those LDAP groups each individually two sets of managed policies. In this particular example, if a user makes a call into the vending service and is in the LDAP group associated with managed policy one, they get a token that only contains managed policy one. They only have access to the first bucket. If they make a call in with both LDAP groups, they get both managed policies, they get both buckets, or they could get just bucket two.
So ultimately, this is a simple, scalable solution that, you know, will save you some money because fewer clusters to run in the, like in the old model. There are fewer IAM roles to manage. It's really a great architecture. Thanks for sharing it with us.
Thank you.
We hope you enjoyed this look into some of the ways our customers are building security with AWS Cloud Solutions. Find out more by watching the full episodes from the links in the description. And keep watching This Is My Architecture.